I've got a firm foundation. I'll rock the only solid ground.
You know, today we're talking about Jesus being the resurrection and the life. And throughout this series, we've been talking about how people describe Jesus. And there's lots of different ways that people describe him. Some think that he is a great teacher, but that's it. He can't possibly be the Son of God. Others think that he is a miracle man. He has got the answers, the cures, and he's there to fix what ails you. Other people just, you know, they think that we're crazy to follow after this man, Jesus. But how does he describe himself in his own words? So we've been going through the book of John and listening to Jesus in his own words. And so first week we talked about Jesus saying, I am the light of the world, which basically means he's here to expose that which is in the darkness. Now, this isn't an easy thing for you and I because we like to store our stuff in the darkness. We like to tuck it away in that far-off closet in the deepest corners of life. But Jesus wants to expose, to bring to light that which is dark in us so that he can begin to fix it. And so he's there really to extend his grace to you and I in those times, but that grace sometimes brings about pain, brings about humiliation. And last week you talked about Jesus saying, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd brings with it this idea that he's here to guide us, the sheep, in life. He's here to provide the needs that we have. You know, the sheep didn't just, you know, pull up to Hy-Vee and say, hey, give me a bag of groceries here. You know, hey, can somebody grab me, some milk and some eggs? The sheep had to rely on the good shepherd to lead them into the green pasture. They weren't going to stumble upon it very well themselves. He was there to protect them in the face of their enemies. He was there to discipline them whenever they would get lost, the way they would get off course. And you and I, sometimes our head is down, we just plow ahead and we miss the mark. And so Jesus wants to get us back on course, not because he wants to hurt us, but really because he cares for us. And so there are some things that from last week kind of carry over into this week a little bit. We can go back to John in chapter 10, starting in verse 11 in our Bibles. If you don't have a Bible here today, there's a couple options for you. We've provided some Bibles, and we're going to be on page 583 in that. If you don't have one, feel free to take one of these Bibles, our gift to you. And if you have a smartphone and you want to pull up a Bible on your app, you can definitely do that. Go to your app store, type in Bible. You'll probably come across YouVersion. It's a great resource there for you, and we'd love to have you dive into that with us. So John chapter 10, verse 11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. Remember, we're talking about the resurrection and the life, and so Jesus is there to protect us. He's there to serve as the gate, so any predator is going to have to go over his dead body to get to us. And he's saying, I'm willing to lay that down for you. Chapter 10, verse 17 says, for this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. That's a profound statement. Jesus saying that nobody really takes my life. I offer my life. And the craziest thing of all is that I pick it back up again. The people who were listening to Jesus had to just be standing in amazement. Like, what does this dude mean? He lays down his life. He picks it back up. This isn't a sweater. This isn't a polo. You don't take it off and put it back on again. So how does this work? He says in chapter 10, verse 10, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but I came, Jesus came, that you and I can have life and have it abundantly. But after last week, something that we didn't dive into, just at the end of chapter 10, right before we push on into chapter 11, is this idea that the Pharisees, which would be the church leaders of the time, they didn't really care much for what Jesus was saying. This whole idea that he had the power to lay down his life and pick it back up again, they kind of drew a fence to that, and they just asked him, like, tell us plainly, are you the Christ? And in our words today, that basically meant that they knew that Jesus promised that a Savior was going to be coming later. Are you that Savior? Are you the anointed one of God? Are you the Son of God? Jesus' response in that section of Scripture is this: my miracles, they speak for me. Like, how else do you think I make the blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk? This is only through the power of God. And so he is in an essence responding to them by saying, yep, I'm the man. And they did not like that one bit. Probably what they didn't like even more so was that he had just called them on the carpet. Because he was talking about how he knows his sheep and his sheep know him. And they're like, well, we don't know what you're talking about. And he's like, that's because you're not one of my sheep. He's basically saying, church leaders of the time, you're a bunch of hypocrites. You're not the true believers. You're actually deceiving the people. So you're not with me. It never goes well if you take your authority and stand against that of the church. It seems like pride and arrogance, even inside of the church, is still a big thing. And that's what they were facing. And so they got their pride, their arrogance, his working of miracles, his boldly saying that, yes, my miracles speak for myself. And they're like, dude, let's stone him. So they pick up stones. They're getting ready to hurl. He snakes away, finds a way out. I don't know what it is. I doubt it was some trap door stuck there in the soil. But what we do know is that he makes his way out and they wanted to kill him. And so in an effort to find safety, have you ever played that game of tag? You know, and there's that safe zone. Like, this is the base. Okay, so he's going away from all of the action so that he can find some safety. And so he goes beyond the Jordan River. If you're not familiar with the landscape of this area that we're talking about, just visualize it a little bit. Let's say the Mediterranean Sea is over here, and the Jordan River is connecting the Sea of Galilee up north to the Dead Sea in the bottom. The Jordan River is where Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, and the Holy Lands is kind of in the middle. And so he's over here in Bethany, in Jerusalem, in that area. Because of the hostility, he goes on the other side of the Jordan. That's kind of like going to Canada. Like, I am beyond your jurisdiction. I have now crossed the international line. You can't touch me, kind of a thing. And this is where Jesus is at in chapter 11 as we pick back up again. It says, now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother was Lazarus that was ill. Now this is just actually in chapter 12, so one page over, you're going to find in chapter 12 that Mary is anointing Jesus' feet with oil, wiping with her hair. It's kind of a crazy, amazing level of worship with abandonment that she's got going on here. And you see this kind of compassion with Mary throughout those stories that take place. Jesus was not a stranger to Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Matter of fact, he had stayed with them before. You can go back to Luke in chapter 10, where Jesus is staying with the family and Jesus is teaching the people. And Martha, she was in the kitchen. She was getting things ready. And some of you and I, we associate with that mindset. We've got company. We got to make sure all of our ducks are in a row. You know, the house has been swept. The dishes are done. The laundry has been taken care of, or at least the door is sealed with maximum security. And we are ready for the company. And when the company comes, we don't sit down because we're serving them. We're making sure that we tend to their needs. And that was Martha. Martha was a go-getter. Mary, while all of this was taking place, was sitting in at the feet of Jesus, just like, teach me. She was a sponge, just soaking it all up. And Martha was getting a bit ticked. Jesus, come on. Can you tell her to get to work? I need some help here. Jesus is like, man, this is where she belongs. This is what she needs. This is more important than going off and doing the dishes. So Mary was a lot more contemplative, and you're going to see that kind of carry out through this story a little bit as well, the different personalities and types. And so the message is pretty important. So Mary and Martha are sending word to Jesus via a letter carrier to beyond the Jordan so that he knows that Lazarus is ill. Here's some things that aren't written in the text that I think you can properly assume. Number one is they knew where Jesus was at. Okay, this wasn't like type an email, hey Jesus, your friend Lazarus, he's fallen ill. This isn't a pick up the phone, dial a friend. You're not sending a text message. You're sending a letter carrier who kind of needs to know where they're going, especially if it's an urgent matter that something needs tended to. So Mary and Martha probably knew exactly where Jesus was at so that they could send this letter. The second thing is they probably knew exactly why Jesus was there. He was there because there was a threat on his life. And so if you're a friend of Jesus and you know there's a threat on his life and you know where he's at, the only reason you would send a messenger is because this is important. This is urgent. So when they get word that a certain man was ill, this wasn't like, yeah, he's got the cold, you know, sniffles a little bit. Like, this was a major deal. Jesus, come back and take care of this. But the reality is that for you and I think that we've all been there, and some of us are there right now. Maybe not in the form of a letter, but we get this notification that something's not quite right. That someone that we love has fallen ill. Somebody that we know is battling cancer. Somebody that we know has just lost their life. Somebody that we know their marriage is in trouble. Somebody that we know has just lost their job. And sometimes that somebody is us. Sometimes we haven't figured out those workplace dynamics and we're struggling with a boss-to-worker mentality. Some of us are struggling with a sibling or a parent or a child. And I think that all of us could probably put ourselves into the story right here. And we get this letter that something is not quite right. But Jesus has a couple of responses to this letter. And let's look at them in verse 4. But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." I think Jesus understood the urgency, but what does he communicate? What does he communicate to his disciples? I think when he said, hey, this does not result in death. This is for God's glory. They're like, oh, hey, it's no biggie. Right? That's probably how you and I would perceive it if somebody got that text message, oh, hey, so-and-so's ill, and you're like, yeah, it's not going to result in death. They're all right. It's good. I'm like, okay. If that's what it takes, we'll say a little prayer for him, but we're good to go. Can't imagine what maybe Mary and Martha were thinking. You know, they sent this letter, you know, expressing urgency. Obviously, they were taking a huge risk in sending for Jesus, and yet Jesus is not coming. I mean, I don't know if that messenger went back or if he stayed there. I mean, if he went back, he's probably like, you know, hey, Jesus said this isn't going to result in death. It's going to be for God's glory. Man, Mary and Martha got to be thinking like, really? Really? Does he know how Lazarus is? Does he know what the condition of his life is? Does he know the struggle that's taking place? And I think that you and I, we need to hear this message for us. You need Jesus to speak into your life maybe today and say, whatever you're dealing with, whatever financial insecurity, whatever marriage or relational struggle, whatever illness or disease or death that is knocking at your door, that you hear the words of Jesus say that even though you only get the surface level, I understand the depths of this issue. And this issue, if you have faith in me, will not result in death. Matter of fact, it's going to be for the glory of God. But probably, just like the disciples, you're trying to figure out how to receive that. Because it was after Jesus got this message, he ran right away to Bethany. No. If you know the story, if you've read it, if you're following along, you know that Jesus stayed where he was at for 2 more days. Doesn't he love Lazarus? Doesn't he care about Lazarus? Doesn't he have a heart for his friend? Why is he staying for 2 more days? I believe it's because he has peace in knowing that God's plan is superior to his own. He knows that God is going to provide in this situation. He knows without a shadow of a doubt that this illness will not result in death and that this will be for the glory of God. Now for you and I, great things happen when we understand the outcome already. Some of you may be following along in the whole March Madness type of thing. This is the first year in a while I haven't filled out a bracket. But I understand that there was a basketball game last night. And if you happen to be a fan of a certain team from a certain state to the south of us who was playing and you had high hopes that this team was going to go all the way, and you heard that little da-da-da-da, da-da-da on your phone, you may have been a little scared. You know, is this the victory chant or is this the song of defeat? And so the song of defeat comes on and you're like, oh, I can't tune in. This is just too painful to watch. But if you're a poorly misplaced Oregon fan in the center of the United States of America going, oh, I don't know if I want to watch that. This is kind of, I don't know, this is kind of iffy. Is this going to happen? And you get that, da-na-na, da-na-na, you're like, dude, they've almost got, there's just only a couple minutes left. We got to tune in. We got to watch this thing because it's going down. It's about to happen. Huge upset. This is going to be awesome. You watch the game differently. And I think that that's the anticipation of Jesus. Guys, I already saw how this ends. I already saw this whole thing play out. I have a peace that just allows me to kind of do what needs to be done because I know when I need to go. I know how I'm going to get there. I know what's going to play out in this scenario. And the problem is that you and I, we don't. And so we begin to fear and to antagonize over these things. I mean, we begin to respond like the disciples that when Jesus said, okay, guys, it's time to go, they're like, it's been 2 days. Like, why would we go now? You already said this disease, this illness is not going to result in death. Why go now? Jesus, don't you realize that these people back there, they want to kill you. Kill you, Jesus. Not mostly dead. All the way dead. They want to kill you, Jesus. And so, Jesus had a response. Kind of goes back to week one, I am the light. Like, you know, this darkness, but I know the light. I know the way. I trust in God to provide. I know how to get through this scenario, through this situation. So trust me. The disciples had fear. You and I, when bad things happen, when times get tough, that's a natural response, isn't it? We get afraid. We get afraid of the unknown. We get afraid of counting the costs and just how devastating this could be. The truth of the matter is we need to have faith in a God who knows the end. And if we flip over to the book of Revelation, we see the story of a Jesus who isn't just the author of life, but he makes all things new again. And so it doesn't matter the struggles that we go through. He's got it all worked out. And when we believe that with all our heart, it gives us a peace when everything else seems to be in turmoil. When life seems to be nothing but raging rivers and high winds, we still have comfort in knowing God is in control. The other thing I think that we do is we get confused. Sometimes we think that we know all the story, all of the situation, when in reality we've only got a small snippet of the full story. We've just gotten the surface level of knowledge when in fact there's much greater depth to the whole story. If you would have just looked at this story from the immediate approach, you would have went like, hey, Lazarus is sick, he's dying, this is an immediate need, Jesus should go back. Why isn't Jesus going back? And you miss the underlying element of this is for the glory of God. And how does God use the bad things in life for his good? It's a tough struggle that we come across. And so the disciples, they're kind of missing it because Jesus said, well, he's asleep. All right, wake him up. Doesn't he have an alarm? Like, why isn't he waking up? Jesus is like, come on, guys. He's dead. Dead. Not mostly dead. All dead. Completely dead. He's dead. Now, if I heard this as a disciple, this is how I'd respond. So those people want to kill you. Lazarus is dead. Why do we need to go back? Not quite adding up, Jesus. But then there was this man named Thomas. Thomas, at the end of Jesus' life, is known for his doubt. Like, he's got to touch the hand of Jesus. He's got to touch his side to know that he's really alive after he's been crucified. And it's Thomas, of all of the disciples, that says, all right, Jesus, if you're going, come on, guys, we're going to go die too. If you're rushing a strong arm into this battle, we got your back. Quite frankly, for those of us who sometimes head into hostile situations, we want to know we've got those kind of people who've got our back. We want to know that when Braveheart is taking place, and they'll never take our lives, they may take our lives, but they'll never take our freedom. We want to know that other guys are going to march to their certain death along with us. I can't believe that Jesus was probably as flattered. He was probably going back to, okay, Thomas, this is for you too. I already told you, I'm the light. I'm going to go through this process. This is for the glory of God. Come along, fellas. Let's watch a show. So he goes back to the area where people were trying to kill him. Obviously, he made it all right, because it says as he's getting to Bethany that Martha runs out to meet him. Martha was, she was the go-getter, right? Martha wanted to run out and meet Jesus, and her statement to Jesus was kind of strange. But maybe you and I can relate. Jesus, if you'd have just been here, I know that my brother would still be alive. Jesus, if you'd have just been here, when is it that you have said that in your life? Jesus, if you were just true, if you were real, you would be here. Jesus, how could you possibly allow this situation to happen or that situation to happen? Why is this illness taking place? Why is this bankruptcy in the process? Why are these struggles happening to me? I've done all of this stuff, Jesus. If you'd have just been here, it'd have been all right. And you can receive it that way. And there probably was an element of frustration, especially if Mary and Martha received that messenger back, and yet their brother died anyway. But I believe that there's a deeper message. And that deeper message is echoed in what she says a bit later in verse 22. In verse 22, she says, "But even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you." And Martha's statement to Jesus was a statement of faith. Jesus, if you would have just been here. Jesus, if you'd only been here. I know that through your power, through your authority, that my brother would be alive. But maybe a hint of frustration. Maybe a hint of sorrow. You and I, we've been there. Bad things happen. Times get tough. The struggles get real. And I wonder if you would be willing to follow Jesus into certain danger. I wonder that when the bad things happen, would you and I be able to express faith in Jesus to say that, but even now, I believe. Maybe life right now has got you in one of those situations where time is tough. The struggle is real. The depression has set in. The anxiety has taken over. Money is tight. Relationships are few. And you need to come face to face with Jesus and say, even now, I believe. Even now. Because when you have that kind of faith in the face of disappointment, that's where peace comes from. Trusting in a Savior who already knows the end. Jesus is the kind of guy that makes the impossible possible. Jesus is the kind of guy that takes death and turns it to life. And Jesus turns this whole story back over to Martha. And he says, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will never die. And he who believes in me, even though he dies, he will live again. This promise of life. And Martha, she receives this from a story that she'd heard Jesus say time and time again about coming back again and about these stories of this new life. If we know Scripture, we would know that in Genesis, when God created Adam and Eve, when He created the first man and the first woman, He created them to live forever. But in our sin, death was the result. And it's in that death that we were separated from life. But the promise in Jesus is that life is coming back again, where we get to be with God forever in heaven, where Jesus is there. The source of life is real. And that's something that we need to tap into. And so Jesus asked, do you believe this, Martha? She goes, yeah, I believe this. You know, my brother, he's not going to die. Jesus is like, no, you're not hearing me. Like, do you believe in me? Because I can make the impossible possible. And her statement of faith resounded. Yes, Jesus, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God. Even in despair, Martha was boldly professing faith, where many of us would run in fear. Verse 28. When she said this, she went and called for her sister Mary, saying in private, the teacher is here and is calling for you. And so Mary, probably being again that more contemplative person, sitting around mourning, hanging with people, doing the relational thing, as soon as she heard that Jesus was asking, she took off immediately. It wasn't that she didn't care before, but she took off and immediately she dropped before Jesus. Same statement. Jesus, if you'd only been here, I know my brother would still be alive. Statement again of the faith of these two ladies and what that meant. And when the Jews who were with her in the house, they were consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly, they went after. So it wasn't just Mary, it was Mary and all of the others who were mourning with. At this point, Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. 4 days, that meant that they were already mourning, that meant that he had already been buried, that meant that he was already rotting and decaying, because that's what dead people do. And so they went out, and as Mary fell at the feet of Jesus, and was moved to tears, and the others with her moved to tears. Jesus, you probably know this part, he wept. It says, matter of fact, 3 times over, he was deeply moved, he was greatly troubled. Jesus wept. And as the onlookers were watching, they responded in one of two ways. The first way is, wow, he must have really loved this man. They saw the compassion of Jesus spill out. But there were still others who were gathered around that were like, dude, if this Jesus is all that, why didn't he come back and save him from death? Sometimes we get caught into those traps, don't we? We think, oh, there's the compassion of Jesus. He loves us so much. Even when times are tough, Jesus loves us. But then there are other times we're like, Jesus, if you were only here. Jesus, why couldn't you heal this? Jesus, why couldn't you stop this? Jesus, are you even there? But it says that he was deeply moved again in verse 38, and he came to the tomb. The tomb was a cave with a large stone in front of it. You probably know this story if you've ever been to an Easter service and you hear the story of Jesus. It was common for the people at that time to be put into a cave and a large stone rolled over the top. Now, Jesus, he asked for something pretty profound. He asked the people to move the stone. And the response makes sense. One pastor that I heard talk about this story, he alluded back to the King James Version, and what it says there apparently is, "He stinketh." It's probably pretty accurate. 4 days dead, he probably does stinketh a bit. And so it took a lot of faith for those people to roll the stone away so that Jesus could begin the approach. And then Jesus began to pray. And the crazy thing is that Jesus could have prayed a lot of things. He could have said, "Hey God, this is your son here. You know, these people, they all need to believe. So if you could just pretty please, fingers crossed, could you just bring Lazarus back to life? Like, it'd be a really good thing." He could boldly ask God, "In the name of myself, would you bring Jesus back or bring Lazarus back to life?" Could have boldly made that declaration. But in the words of Jesus, "God, I thank you for already having heard me." Do you ever pray with that kind of power and authority? Do you ever have that kind of faith in God that says, "You have already heard my prayers, and so for that I give you praise"? I can only think of a few times in my life where I've prayed with that kind of power and authority. I remember a young lady coming to me at camp one time, and I put my hands on her and I began praying for her and the difficulties that she was going through. And there was just this overwhelming sense of the power of the Holy Spirit in that moment. And I began to pray as if though the power of Jesus were right there in the room and that the healing was already taking place. I have no idea if it did. Didn't see her again. Didn't see any kind of miraculous thing happen. But I saw the power of God at work. And I wish I could say it was that way all the time. But that's the kind of power and the kind of faith that Jesus had in God. And to make it even more bold, he does something that probably only the most insane or the most powerful people would ever do. He calls into the darkness of the cave, into the tomb, and he says, "Lazarus, come outside." Can you imagine how wrong this could have gone? "Lazarus, come out! Lazarus, 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 come out! Come out, wherever you are, come out!" It could have gone really bad, really fast. So the people had to have faith to remove the stone. Jesus obviously had faith in his prayer. And he had faith to call this dead man to come out. And he could have looked like an idiot. But Jesus has that power. And I wonder if in this story where you would place yourself. As you've gotten the letter, as you've experienced the tough times, if you've gone through the struggles and you're locked into your own tomb of sin and devastation, of guilt and frustration, of agony and despair, depression and anxiety, whatever's holding you back, as you're locked away in there and you have been prepared for death. And Jesus speaks into your life, "This will not result in death, but this is for the glory of God." Do you hear him when he's calling? Do you feel the power of his connection with God that's flowing through? Because some of you are at a point in your life where the stone is still in place. And Jesus says, in order for you to come back, you need to roll the stone away. You need to roll the scars away. You need to roll the hurt away. You need to roll the bandages away. And you need to deal with death. You need to deal with pain. You need to deal with hurt. And so some of you right now today, you've heard the stories time and time again, but the callus keeps getting thicker. Will you have faith to roll the stone away? Some of you are inside, wrapped in your grave clothes, and you're hearing the voice of Jesus. And you're like, "Yes, I believe Jesus. But kind of cool here. I don't want to change my life, Jesus. I don't want anything to be different. I'm comfortable here. I'm okay here. Nothing is changing. There's no high call being put on my life. Like, it's okay. You believe in Jesus, but you're not moving. You're okay just living in death and despair. And I hope and I pray that today you hear the voice of Jesus saying you don't have to stay dead. There is a true love calling you out. Some of you have been called out. And it says that Lazarus was standing there on the outside of the tomb, wrapped in his grave clothes, these little strips of linen that had been soaked in spices and herbs just to mask the aroma, the stench of death. And they said, take his grave clothes off and let him go. As some of you have answered the call of Jesus, and you've risen from your deathbed, and you are now outside of the tomb, but you're still living dead. You're still doing what's already been done, what's always been done. It's too hard to change. God will always love me. He will always forgive me. And you don't realize that you reeketh of death. And Jesus is calling you to experience life more abundantly. He wants you to strip off the grave clothes and begin to walk as though you were alive in Christ. And so we have the same presentation before us. That as Jesus said in chapter 11, verse 25, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Yes, hear this question. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Where are you at? What's your next step? Is it to roll the stone away? To step out of the grave? To drop the grave clothes? He is the Christ, the Son of God.